Let's talk about data preparation. Before we move into any analysis, we're going to have to do a lot of data cleaning and organizing and understanding. Unfortunately, that takes the bulk of the time. However, once you're done with that, you get to do all the fun stuff. So let's look at different things that we have to consider when we're going through the data preparation stage. So, thinking about collecting data. Either you're going and collecting the data especially for this project, maybe you're deploying an experiment or a survey, or else you're going and collecting data that already exists, you're going to have to consider a bunch of different issues. First of all, you're going to have to think very carefully about where the data are coming from. What's the quality of the data? Are these data going to be able to obtain in the future? For instance, if you're going to be deploying a predictive model, then you want to continue obtaining these types of measurements in the future. So thinking about the data origin, the quality, the consistency are important points to take into account. Now, many times the aha moments come not from using a data set that sits already in one place, but by merging data sets from multiple sources. It can be multiple departments. Maybe it's customer data from the marketing department with operations data from another department, from accounting. Maybe you're even including data that are somehow outside that you either purchased through a third-party company, or maybe it's publicly available data, maybe it's social media data. Merging data sources is extremely useful. However, it's also challenging because it means that we need a key. In order to merge records, we need to have some kind of an ID that enables us to merge these records. And issues of duplications and corruption are very, very common. Yet, it's definitely worth trying to find useful data sources to merge together. In some software, such as Spotfire, it's relatively easy to merge data from multiple files if you have this type of key. Tableau also is pretty good at supporting this type of combination. And of course, you can use any type of database software that you know of. The next question you're going to ask is, given these data, can I even try to address the objective that I set up? Are these data likely to even support answering this question? Sometimes just by brainstorming and pretending and setting up possible scenarios, you'll find out that the data that you have, it would be impossible to achieve the objective that you set up front. So that's a very important role-playing and scenario-building stage that you want to set up before you even start investing in the data and in the analysis. And finally, remember, this is not data dredging, where you're just trying to find something and running menus and something comes out. Domain knowledge is going to be one of the most important pieces aside from all the analytics. It's going to be integrated in every step of the analysis, even at the data cleaning and preparation stage. Let's look at how. Well, the first thing you have to do is you have to understand what your data are about. And by that is we need to understand what are the measurements, where are they coming from, what are the metrics. What you see on the slide is what we call read the label. So before you want to even touch your data, you want to make sure you understand the ingredients. What does that mean? Again, first of all, you're going to have lots of columns. You might even have hundreds of them. You still will need a data dictionary that describes what each one of these variables is. And make sure to keep that data dictionary because you might forget later on, or you might have to share the results with other analysts who will need a data dictionary. Other thing you'll need to know is, what type of measurements are these? Are these dates? Are these categorical numbers? Because maybe you're coding gender as 1 and 2, but the software won't know that these are categorical variables unless you tell it to. Are these geographical coordinates if you're going to do some mapping? So you want to make sure that you understand not only what each variable means, but also what scale it's measured on. Third, range of variables. You have some column. How much of a range is there? Maybe everyone has a number 1 on that. And in that case, obviously, that variable is not very interesting. Easy things that you can do to determine ranges of variables is just generate a summary statistics table. or look at charts. So lots of interactive visualization can actually help you discover all kinds of interesting and scary things. Duplications are another issue that might happen, especially when you're merging data from multiple sources. So again, software can help you detect some of these things, but you'll have to be on the lookout. And finally, extreme numbers, outliers, maybe typing errors, maybe errors for some other reason. Make sure that you identify them, because as you've probably seen in the statistics course, outliers can actually throw off the whole analysis. Graphics, charts are great at detecting outliers, especially if you're doing lots of interactive stuff where you can get a better feel of the interdependence between many variables. An outlier might not be extreme on one measurement or on a second measurement, but when you look at both of them, that little measurement is outside of the cloud. Last step is what I call data preparation, but what I mean here is that you want to actually think about which variables you're actually going to be using. Now, remember again that you might have many measurements and you understand what they are. You're still going to have to use your domain knowledge with a little freeform thinking here to determine which variables are even going to be considered further. Questions like, if this is a predictive task, will these measurements be available in the future? Is it expensive to measure these variables? Maybe we don't want to measure them anymore because they're too expensive. Maybe the quality of these variables is so low that we'd rather not even use them anymore. So all these questions you should ask upfront and decide whether you're going to include them or not. The fact that they're in the data set doesn't mean that you should automatically use them. Choice of scales. Remember that we talked about numerical versus categorical. Sometimes people will actually give you, let's say, income or salary numbers, but you're really not interested in that granularity level in terms of the objective, because the objective is not going to care about a whole continuous range. And in that case, you might say, okay, so let's just bin it into low income, medium income, and high income. But the flip side is, if you're going to be binning numerical variables, and those are going to be predictor variables, you're going to have to create a whole lot of dummies, which increases your dimension, lots and lots of columns. So think carefully what is going to be the role of this measurement and what is the objective, and according to that, think whether you want to bin or to unbin, etc. Missing values is one of the most serious issues that always occurs in a data set, and there's never one right answer of how to deal with them. One option, which is what all software do, many times people are not aware of this, is if you run an analysis and some of the records are missing even one value, the software is just going to drop those records out. If you have 1 million records, but 90% of them are missing one certain value because maybe the people don't answer that sensitive question, your analysis is not running on 1 million records. It's running on 10% of that number. So if you're going to drop records, make sure that you assess what is the extent of the missing value. If there are only few records with missing values, yes, you might as well drop them out, unless they're very interesting for some reason. Another option is sometimes you have a variable that is just terribly missing. For instance, maybe this is a question that nobody understood, so no one answered. And in that case, it would make sense to drop a variable, thereby removing lots and lots of missing values. But think carefully whether that variable is pivotal to the analysis, and maybe you'll have to go and figure out what the data were. Now, obviously, in some cases, it's just a download problem, and you can go back to the source and fill in the missing values. So such corruptions are technically possible to solve. There's a big statistical literature about imputation, meaning filling in missing values. And there are different ways of doing this. For instance, if you have age that's missing for a certain person, you might just plug in the average age of your entire sample. You can plug in the median. You can decide to plug in something else. So those are options. Another option is, suppose again age is missing, you might build some kind of a model that predicts age and then use those predictions to fill in the missing age numbers. That's another option. A third option is sometimes the missingness is actually really interesting. Suppose we're looking at tax returns and some people don't submit a certain form. and you're trying to detect fraudulent tax returns, would you want to impute that missing form? Probably not, because maybe the fact that people don't report that information is indicative of being fraudulent. So sometimes the missingness is informative for the prediction. And in that case, a solution is to create a dummy variable that says, is it missing or not? And dump out the original variable. Okay, you're going to have to think whether you're explaining or predicting, because whether you fill in a number, or you discard the observation, or you put in a dummy of missingness, really depends on your goal. So think carefully about your objective and what's going to happen when you approach the missing values in that particular way. A very interesting article by professors at NYU, Stern School of Business, showed that there's actually another approach that not many people consider. And that is, if some people are not reporting their income, and other people are not reporting their age, and other people are not reporting their education level, for instance, and all these are input variables, you might build separate models. Some models that don't have education in them. Some models that don't have age in them. And then when a new person comes in, you check which missing values they have and choose the predictive model accordingly. So you have to think creatively about how to use data mining, even at the missing value stage. Lastly, there's the step of creating derived variables. Although you have the original measurements, we already talked about creating dummy variables from categorical variables. Sometimes you'll also create other types of derived variables. We just talked about another one, a missingness dummy. That's a derived variable. Sometimes you might sum up a few columns together to get some total of interest. Creating the derived variables is also based on domain knowledge and understanding what the measurements mean. But definitely a very important step before you actually go ahead and start your analysis. So now you're armed with lots of different techniques and approaches for preparing your data. I hope that you have a neat data set at this point and that you start cleaning it up and preparing it for analysis.